Good morning, everyone. Nice to see everyone. Welcome to God's house of healing, God's house of strength, God's house of prayer, joy, praise. That's what we're here for, to share today and to share with all those during the week as well. I'm Pastor Ken and Joan. We're happy to be back. Thanks for your thoughts and prayers. We were 5 days in Salzburg and 5 days in Vienna and 2 days traveling. So we enjoyed the castles and the Danube and the Bavarian Alps, and Joan was able to chase down the places for the Sound of Music film, and it was a lot of fun. So thanks for your thoughts and prayers, and it's really good to be back, and we praise God for Pastor Bruce and Jeb the last 2 weeks. We'll be here these next 4 Sundays, so we're thankful for that. And we asked Bruce last week if we could wait till this Sunday to do a special service on the Trinity, because the whole service, all the songs and all the parts of it are all based on the Trinity, and to help us understand, you know, God is triune, we're made in God's image as triune, what does that mean in our lives as well? So let us continue this morning. And also, if you haven't got this new daily bread, it begins next month in July, August, and September. So pick one of those up. So let us continue this morning, and thanks for being here. And maybe thanks for bringing a bulletin to someone who can't be here, and give it to them so they can watch on television this week as well. It's a nice way to be a disciple and reach out. As we gather, by the work of the Holy Spirit, God's people are truly his very own sons and daughters. Yet our Father in heaven is not distant or aloof. He is personal and very concerned about his children. He is the Abba Father, the approachable Daddy, caring for and nourishing countless generations. He continually reveals his glory to us through his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the Holy Spirit, who guides and gives us to carry out our Father's will. Today we praise and worship our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Glorify thy name in all the earth. in the three parts of the Apostles' Creed. And whether you grew up in Church of the Creed or not, over 2 billion Christians around the world believe in what the Creed says. And we may not always agree on baptism, communion, the sacraments, or about when Christ is going to return, but everything in the Creed we all believe. There's solid gold. And so we begin with a prayer or litany to the Father. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible.
We are God's children, and He is our Father, and yet we live in a sinful world.
We wrestle with a sinful nature, and face a strong enemy in Satan.
Let us therefore humble ourselves and confess our sin and rebellion before our merciful God together. Almighty God, through your Son, you have invited us to call you Abba, Father, when we pray, and yet we shy from that closeness and hide in our sin. Your name is holy, O God, but we who wear your name by baptism live unholy lives. Our will fights against your gracious will, and we rebel against your kingdom by our thoughts, words, and deeds. Hear our prayer of confession, gracious Father, and by your Son's death and resurrection, rescue and restore us as your beloved sons and daughters. Help us to live to the praise of your glory, as your forgiven and free people. Amen. Jesus is the Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world, and by his glorious resurrection and victory over death, we can be assured that our sins are totally forgiven, that we may live with him forever here on earth and one day in heaven.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. in Austria was a little town called Mondsee, M-O-N-D-S-E-E. It's by a lake. And that was where they filmed the wedding in the Sound of Music. And so it was nice to just be there. Think of this song as well, even though we use different words for it, which are beautiful. So let's continue now with our litany to the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity. I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life,
who proceeds from the Father and the Son,
with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified,
who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. O Holy Spirit, thank you for the wisdom and the understanding you send us. Please continue to deliver us from all sin and evil and the assaults of the devil. Thank you for the gifts you bless us with. Come, O Holy Spirit. Amen. It is my joy and delight as your pastor, and by the command and promise of our Lord Jesus Christ, to announce to you, to us, that all our sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, our amazing triune God. Amen. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty, and darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was. Our first reading. Our second reading is the bookends of Genesis 1. As you know, it's so beautiful. John 1. John writes, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. He was the God in the beginning, and through him all things were made, and without him nothing was made that has been made. And the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Here ends our second reading, and then finally, the Holy Gospel, the great commission that Jesus gave us before he ascended. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." These are the words of our God, our child God. Amen. You know, the Trinity is such a mystery, but it's so beautiful. In some ways, it's so simple. You know, think about God created us in his image. And what is God's image? It's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Well, think about us. You know, we're body, mind, and spirit, and soul. You know, we're like the mind of God and the body of Christ and the soul, the spirit of God in us that live forever. You know, it's amazing just how this whole area is. And I found a special Trinitarian prayer. I wanted to begin with a prayer, but before I do, maybe one thing that art and paintings can help us maybe understand a little more of the mystery. You know, here's that one light, one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit coming down. And here's a beautiful prayer. It's a real simple prayer. Sometimes we forget that the whole Trinity is always about love and about reaching out to us in God's love in Christ through His Spirit. And so this is a beautiful prayer by Sister Barbara Jean. She's of the Trinity. So she's dedicated her whole life to the Trinity. And so she wrote this simple prayer. And it's a personal prayer, individual, but I like we can pray for ourselves as well. Prayer to the Trinity. God, Trinity, hidden in my soul, I praise and thank you for your gift of love. You have breathed into my soul the desire to be united with you in love. And may this desire be realized in me through the hidden work of love. I surrender myself completely to your loving embrace. Transform all that would keep this desire from being fulfilled. And may my love for you be selfless as I continue to deepen in this threefold unity of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. So a couple opening paintings. You know, we have Father, Son, Holy Spirit, inseparable. But yet there's only one God. Hear, O Israel, remember? Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. And you shall worship him with all your heart, your soul, your mind. Remember Moses' brother Aaron, when he gave the benediction? It's one God, but it's in three persons. You know, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance. You know, what does it say in Genesis 1:27? God is speaking and he says, "Let us make man in our image." He's not talking to the angels. He's talking to the Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It's beautiful. This is kind of a mysterious painting. I like it though. You got Jesus in this hidden there. You have the Father, you have the Son, and the Spirit as well. Most of you have seen this diagram, probably. It's, you know, one God overall in the center. You know, there's the Father, there's the Son, there's the Spirit. But the Father is not the Son is not the Spirit is not the Father or the Son. But it says the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. I love that. I love when it says Jesus Christ, very God, but very God, begotten, not made. The Jehovah's Witnesses, and even in the 3rd, 4th century, there was a heresy that was dividing the whole church. And what it says, there was God up there, and then Jesus hadn't existed yet. And then God created him. But that's not what the Bible says. And then it says that then the Spirit came much later. Like some people believe it's God in the Old Testament, Jesus born in the New, and then the Spirit at Pentecost. But it's one God, isn't it? One God in three persons. And so, you know, there wasn't a time when Jesus or the Spirit didn't exist, right? He always was. So I love that. being of the same substance with the Father by whom all things are made. That's really important in the Nicene Creed. Being of the same substance with the Father by whom all things are made. You know, really critical. You've all seen this symbol before, probably. A lot of pastors and priests have it on their stoles. You probably have it in the stained glass windows. I noticed there's a Trinity somewhere in here. Over there, I think there's a... Anyway, it's beautiful to have it in the chapels, in the cathedrals as well. I love this one because it shows Jesus the Father and the Spirit and Jesus being crucified. It's such a beautiful painting, even though it's tragic and sad. And how do we know that the Spirit is God, Jesus is God, and the Father is God, but there's only one God? Well, we know it because of the Scriptures, don't we? We know it because the Spirit is called God in Acts chapter 5. Jesus is often called God. Of course, God the Father is called God. Remember the baptism of Jesus? You don't have to take my word for it, right? When Jesus was baptized, he came up out of the water. The Holy Spirit came down in the form of a dove. And the Father said, "This is my beloved Son, who I am well pleased." Remember? Yeah. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, but only one God. But he reveals himself in three persons. I love that. You might remember, this is one of my favorite Trinitarian. We don't even always think of this as the Trinity yet, oftentimes. But do you remember in Luke chapter 1 when Elizabeth and John the Baptist's father and the whole thing, and the angel Gabriel came to Mary? And what happened there? Remember when Mary said, "How can this be?" You know, here it is, God's word. "How can this be, because I'm only a virgin?" And what did the angel say? The angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee, and therefore the holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." Isn't that awesome? Think about it. You know, the Holy Spirit comes, the power of the Most High God overshadows, and that which is born is the Son of God. Awesome. I mean, when do you remember John the Baptist even leapt in his mother's womb as well, Elizabeth's womb, when he heard the voice of Mary, the mother of his Savior as well. And so I go back to Genesis 1:1-3. And you know, we read it. What does it say? In the very beginning, you know, there's nothing here basically, but God always has been, right? And so it says, God is there in the beginning, and the Spirit of God is right there, hovering over the waters, right? And then what does it say? It says, God spoke. God spoke. And when he spoke, the Word, who is the Word? Jesus. He speaks the Word, and all things are created by him and for him and through him, Jesus Christ. In fact, that's what it says right there. Foremost and void, there's the Spirit of God moving over the face, right? And God said that there be light. And then we read this one, right? And I know you know this, but it's so good to realize that in the beginning was the Word. The Word is with God. The Word was God. Jesus is God, right? And then it says, he was with God in the beginning, and through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. And then the Word, I love this. Who is the Word? Well, the Word became flesh, Jesus, and lived among us. Isn't that great? You know, I love it. And we beheld the glory of the only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. In Hebrews 1, it says, "Long ago, at many times and many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world," Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I love that. And of course, you know, Paul writes oftentimes, "Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." You know, he talks about the Trinity all the time. They don't use the word, right? But we know that. And so we know the last thing Jesus said, basically, was go and make disciples, right? Go and make disciples, come follow me, you know, go. And if you can't go, people will come to you. That's what happens here a lot. Some of you are able to go out, drive still. Others can't, like my mom could not. And Joan's mom still does drive at 91. But it's like, if you can't go out, God will bring people to you. Happens all the time. And sometimes when people come to you, they're a little better listeners. Just maybe they don't come that often. You know? So I love this next picture. Here's the whole world, right? Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. It has a verse just before that. What does it say? Jesus says, all authority has been given to me on heaven and on earth. Therefore. Remember, the word, whatever the word therefore, you always realize what the therefore is there for. And it's because everything that just went before it. So all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth, Jesus says. Therefore, go. And remember when Jesus sent out the disciples by twos? If you've seen the series, The Chosen, right? He sends them out. He says, God has given me authority to send you out. It's my disciples. And so I'm sending you out by twos. Don't take anything with you. No food, no bag, no money, nothing. Because I want you to really depend on me and realize this isn't coming from you. It's coming from me. I'll take care of you as well. So how do you make disciples? And I know we know this, but it's so nice to see it. Simple. You make disciples, number one, by going. Or if you can't go, just being open to God's Spirit, right? And He's working. Two, by baptizing. And what do you baptize? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And three, by teaching. And before Jesus sent the disciples out, He said, I want you to go out by two and prepare the way. And they said, well, what are we going to say? And then they just said, just say what I've been saying to you. You know, just tell them what I've been telling you. We don't have to preach ourselves, do we? You know, we can preach Jesus Christ as Lord, Jesus Christ crucified, Jesus Christ risen from the dead, Jesus Christ lives and reigns through all eternity, and He chooses to live and reign in us. Awesome. You know, even though we all screw up all the time. But God likes that, because He likes broken people so the light can shine out of the cracks. I just finished a piece of pottery that was a large piece. It's a platter like this. And when it came out of the kiln, it was broken in half. But it was really beautiful. And this isn't the first time in my life this has happened, of course, as a potter for 50 years. And so I'm glazing it 2 days ago. And as I'm glazing it, I'm spinning on this wheel. And half of it flies, the other half flies off, and it breaks again. And I go, wow, this is so great. So now I'm going to put it together, right? And I'm going to seal it with gold right through there. And in September, when I have my month-long art exhibit downtown, that'll be one of the pieces there of God working through brokenness. And it becomes like gold in our lives as well. Kind of like this beautiful stained glass. This is almost more of a kaleidoscope, right? As you look through it. And then lastly, I love this picture. It's so simple, but there's like the body of Christ, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, based upon God's Word. And probably lastly, before we close with a special song, another reason I realize for myself, and maybe you guys can all relate to this, I hope you can, is because I believe Jesus is triune, not just only because we're made in His image as triune, but because He reveals Himself to us at different times in our life when we need a Father, when we need a Son, when we need the Holy Spirit, when we don't have that. You know, my father left when I was 7. He divorced my mom, and she had 5 children between the ages of 2 and 12. God bless my mom. And God, through her faith, we were a poor family, but God just blessed us through my mom's faith, through the church, whatever. But the thing was that I never really knew my father. And so I remember, you know, I never remember thinking of God as my heavenly father. Not until I was probably 20s or 30s. You know, our Father in heaven didn't really mean a whole lot to me, but Jesus sure did. So Jesus through the Son, you know, I could relate to Jesus as a friend. You remember? You know, the Jesus movement, the renewal movement. You know, Jesus comes alive. Then there's the Holy Spirit later on in my life who gives us all gifts and the fruit of the Spirit, right? And you can't get away from God, can you? I tried for a long time, right? You just end up right there again. And God says, you know, maybe, Ken, it's time to surrender. You know, surrender. Come, follow me. You know, I'll make your life great. The devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I came, John 10:10, that I might give you life, life abundantly, right? Ephesians 3:20 says, to him who is able to do extremely abundantly beyond all you could ask or think, according to his Spirit that works in us. And so I want to close with a special song. You know, I haven't sung this song for 30 years. I bet some of you know it. It's pretty simple. We have it printed, Joan printed out the notes in your bulletin. And I hadn't sung this for 30 years, but as I'm working on my sermon, this song just came to mind. That's what the Spirit does. It just brings songs to mind. So we'll sing through the first verse twice just to get the feel. And there's a verse for Heavenly Father, there's a verse for the Son of God, and there's a verse for the Holy Spirit. So many others here in our Lord's prayers. So I shall begin with these two prayers for God, for praying for peace. Creator of the heavens and the earth, we come to you seeking peace in the world. In the wake of several horrific acts of violence and an incomprehensible number of precious human lives lost, we ask for your comfort and healing touch for all those affected, and for our families and friends near and far. May your consuming love permeate communities everywhere. You are forever merciful, and our expectation resides solely in you. Thank you for hearing our cry. Amen. And Heavenly Father, we are most saddened by the incomprehensible violence that has taken precious human lives and injured others. Please bring help and healing to those who are wounded, and your comfort to those grieving the loss of loved ones. You are the God who intervenes in the affairs of men, and we ask for your help and strength in this time of need. Thank you for always hearing our cry, most faithful God. In your matchless name we pray. Amen. And this is an assurance from God. God says to us, God has heard your prayers. God can feel your pain. He knows that you are overwhelmed, exhausted, and worried about how everything is going to work out. God is saying to you today, to us, trust me, I will get you through this season. I will fix what is broke. Rest in me. And Lord Jesus, thank you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We include all these prayers. You know the prayers of our heart in the one you've taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And may the gracious Lord Jesus Christ, love of our soul, and may God the Father, who sent his Son to us, and his Holy Spirit, proceeding through the Father and the Son, just continue to bless and strengthen us as we're disciples and reach out to others, and as they come to us as well. So thank you for being open to that. And thank you to all the staff and all the help for serving like Christ, because we're really Christ to each other. So let us close with this beautiful song to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
You offer hope without.